Internet of Things makes our cars driverless, our homes connected, our cities smart, and factories run seamlessly. Artificial intelligence combined with IoT data is where the business value is created. Imagine yourself in the driverless world. I will teach you to pivot your career and innovate in your business using IoT, AI, and autonomous vehicles. Let's begin your journey with me today. I'm Sudha Jamthe. We are going to focus on industrial IoT security, and we have an expert who's a repeat guest, Sravani Bhattacharjee. Sravani Bhattacharjee is the principal of Irika Media. Sravani has a new book called Practical Industrial Internet of Things Security. And that's our topic today. Sravani, welcome. Thanks for joining our show.
Thank you, Sudha. Nice to be here again, and thanks for the opportunity.
So before we go deeper into the industrial IoT security, I have a copy of the e-book here. Show me the real book.
Okay.
It's such a colorful book too.
Yes.
Practical Industrial Internet of Things Security. That's your new book. It's out. Available on Amazon.
Exactly. Amazon, Safari, and also the publisher is Fact, and their website FactPub. It is available there too.
Okay. And what got you into industrial IoT? Before even we touch the security aspect of it first.
Sure. My career started actually with industrial companies. Notably Honeywell. I was working on embedded systems which were airborne. So things like automated flight control systems and pilot dashboard and so forth. So those were airborne, meaning they will be on the aircraft, either military or commercial. And the standards of reliability and safety were so high. I think that's where I really got the introduction to the intersection of information technology, computer science with industrial systems. And then I'm always passionate about communications technology, connecting things. And that's how I ended up with Cisco. In Cisco, when I started, it was, you know, those early days when we were still talking about private lease line networks, you know, ATM and frame relay were still very relevant.
People who have been watching the IoT show are familiar with, you know, previous episodes where we've covered, you know, how is AI coming into IoT, or how is this changing our way of life in so many different dimensions or so many different industries, right? But when you say industrial IoT, how broad are you casting your net? Get us to a common definition of industrial IoT. Because again, like, people come at it from where they are working, right? Sure. So there is a definition where people think everything that is not consumer, like the smart city or smart home, mm-hmm. or wearables, is industrial IoT. Is that your definition? Get us to a common starting point.
Sure. It involves pretty much every industry vertical. For example, if you look at energy, if you look at transportation, if you look at there are healthcare. Similarly, every industry vertical that we talk about, as they adopt connected technologies, they are coming into the purview of the industrial Internet of Things. And a very fascinating aspect of the industrial Internet of Things is that we are talking about machines, about physical assets. Yeah. Physical assets ranging from, let's say, turbines, you know, in an energy setting. And then there are, you have oil pumps. If you look at the mining, you know, oil and gas sector, and so forth, you know, those have been like traditional systems which has been there. And then there is, of course, the ICS SCADA systems. These are systems which interact with the physical world in a big way. I mean, if you think of an ICS system in a nuclear plant, or in an energy plant, they are controlling the physical world. I mean, how much energy to create and so forth.
Since I cover autonomous vehicle business, I talk a lot about, you know, transportation system, and it, for me, IoT and smart mobility is kind of interconnected in the way I focus on my research. So. Right. I have covered a lot of transportation systems. You spoke about mm-hmm. energy, mining, oil and gas, so many of them, right?
Right.
Pick one industry that you have been working with and walk us through, tell us, and then you tell us new jargons that you're talking about. I would like to learn that too.
Let's take up a very simple example of wind energy. You know, the one of the natural where we have the wind turbines, and they have the windmills. So that's where that has been traditionally generating power. Now these are physical systems.
Yep.
These are all physical systems: the turbines, the fans, and so forth. Now when that turbine gets connected. Now again, one thing we have to be clear here, that we are using the word internet, but internet does not always mean the public internet as we tend to think. It's about connecting. It's about network connectivity. It can be a private cloud, it can be a public cloud, or it can be just the cloud provider.
Cloud, but it is connecting to the cloud. It's using internet protocols and it's connecting.
Exactly. That's what. So that's one distinction I thought we can point out. Now, when they're connecting, that's where the cyber element of it comes into the picture. So the physical system is now having a stack of internet protocols, and which are open standard based internet protocols, and then this adding that stack and also the connectivity infrastructure makes them a cyber physical system, CPS for short.
Why is the cyber physical system important here?
Yeah, actually, that is really the basis, and that's a very good question, because that's actually the segue to the whole topic about cyber physical security, which is really what industrial IoT security is all about.
Can you walk me through, starting from the edge device, which could be a sensor, right? Mm-hmm. So if somebody is a solutions architect who's listening to this podcast, what do you have as an advice for them on what are the end? What are the pieces as you walk from the edge device, the sensor, all the way up to the cloud and maybe back?
It is a solution architect or, just an operational planner. When we are deploying the endpoints, there's so many constraints. There are legacy systems. It's not just there are resource constrained systems. There are a lot of legacy systems in which they do not even have the provision for upgradability.
Yeah.
So there are the solutions. There are many standards which unfortunately we cannot cover in this short time. But the book covers various standards that has been developed and which can be used, and standards and also mechanisms. For example, when you have a resource constrained device, how you can offload a lot of processing, because security is all about crypto, and it's so much of processing. So there, how you offload some of that. So that's and also laying down an architectural layout of the endpoints, because there also you have a stack. You have those at the field level. You have those at the shops role level, those at the aggregation level, and so forth. So it addresses each of those levels, and more from a solution perspective, how to integrate security, and then communication. When we say communication, it's about encryption, and again the crypto concepts. But there's so much that goes in the communication channels, the protocols which has been adapted mainly for the industrial IoT application, the secure the communication protocols. And then the media, like whether we are talking about wireless, because in the industrial setting, wireless is a very useful media. So whether it is wireline or wireless, so and the whole architectural setting, both at an industrial level, both the traditional architecture where you have a hierarchical architecture, and also the data bus architecture, because industrial IoT is a lot about data.
I was talking to Mrinal Wadhwa about how he came into the security field. Lot of IoT systems have over-the-air updates, right? It could be, my Tesla Model 3 has a OTA update. It could be just a small device, but it gets, it gets the inference model updated periodically, right? So okay. When you get an over-the-air update on a device, how do you know that it is not hacked and you got something else? So it's possible somebody could hack and replace that the next update with something else, which is more vulnerable. So his solution was operating at that level to use blockchain to make sure that that particular OTA is actually got the same signature from wherever it is supposed to come from the cloud. If I hear this right, you're saying there are so many strategies that can be deployed.
Exactly.
And there are best practices at every stage, right? In terms of device management, in terms of managing OTA, in terms of managing the network layer. Okay. And the cloud, right? At every stage, there are best practices, and you have brought that by talking to the experts at every level.
Exactly. And the book covers blockchain more as an emerging, but what is happening, a very good use case you have about OTA is, of course, the signature verification, but the industry does not leapfrog that fast. You know, we go in steps, and we are seeing that even the industrial business leaders, they're very cautious. You know, we are saying that it's the fourth industrial revolution and so forth. But as one of my colleagues, industry colleagues, has rightly pointed out, IoT is more of an evolution. It's not really a revolution, because everybody is taking steps, POCs, and so forth. So that's where, you know, the PKI and the certificate-based authentication is still very much prevalent now. And that's where, you know, and some more standards, IEEE is coming up with the 1609.2 standard. So they are trying to address the resource constraint. You know, PKI was not really built for such resource-constrained devices. So in case of OTA, there can be tunneling, there can be, you know, the crypto envelopes and so forth. There are multiple technologies that come. Yeah, the book mentions about those. So again, going back to our end-to-end architecture, cloud is a single point of failure, which blockchain kind of tries to address by, you know, their distributed model.
I love your idea of thinking about a security strategy, not just in your risk planning, but overall in your business strategy.
We are doing our best to right-size security and so that it is aligned to our investment. But we have to realize that bad things happen. It's all a matter of risk management, how we respond to incidents. You know, in an information security breach, as you mentioned, or about banks, financial sectors, and so forth, you could reach out to your customers. But when I am dealing with, let's say, 10 million machines or things, you know, entities, how do I make them secure overnight? I mean, they may not lose the trust, but the impact it has cascading is huge. Now, having a good incident management plan is, which many IT companies already have, but in industrial IoT, it takes a new shape. So the incident management, once the incidents happen, how to manage. So that also has to be part of the strategy and part of the security program. That's one thing. And another thing is, it's a continuous process. You know, it's how much the threat landscape has changed compared to, let's say, 15 years back till now. I mean, when we started with the IT, we hardly used to think about security, but the threats have, and they will keep evolving. So we have to future-proof. You know, how one thing is that, again, I have to mention Stephen's comment in the foreword. He said that autonomous vehicle, again, your passion, Sudha, is that when an autonomous vehicle is on the road, if something happens to it, it has to be safe. You know, IoT security is about safety, reliability, resilience. Now, something happened, a hack happens to that vehicle, it has to behave in a safe manner. Now, safe doesn't mean the airbag sense safety, but what it really means is that it has to very gracefully come to a stop, not from 65 to 0, which means a big human safety thing. So that we have to incorporate in the system design phase also, like strategy. And then when we are designing the systems, there has to be a graceful, it has to be resilient and reliable. If an incident happens, if a hack happens, it should not just stop working. Just like I have lost password, it is fine in the human world, but in the machine world, it has to come there. We have to build a way that even to the hack, it comes very, it gracefully comes to, it goes to state A to state B.
Especially in industrial IoT, you have M2M. So it's not, you know, it's not just one set of machines all connected to the cloud, and then you have this layer of, you know, software, right? So you have
Actually, just to say, we have M2M, we have M2C, machine to cloud, and also C2M, cloud to machine.
Right, that's right. So tell me, when you have a machine talking to the cloud or machine talking to the machine, if one layer of devices becomes obsolete, and so they're hackable, right? Mm-hmm. So then, you know, maybe that vendor goes out of business and now you have to change, and you might have a device management strategy in place, but while the transition is happening, your system is still secure. So have you looked at examples, or in your research and case studies, have you seen how they manage it? How do they do the device management?
And this is a very important use case in industrial IoT, because, you know, if we talk about smart city, the use case of a smart city, what is a smart city? It involves multiple verticals. It involves the energy sector, the transportation, the control of the traffic, the water systems. Everything is mission critical for running, because if the water gets contaminated, in the book, I cover a case study on how, you know, an ICS system was hacked to contaminate the water, the chemicals used in the water. So in a smart city deployment, is a very typical example of systems of systems, where there are interconnected systems coming into play. So, this is a very common situation that we have to, because we are also talking about subscription-based models nowadays. Most business model in industrial IoT is subscription-based, where my data is traversing, it's not just limiting to an organizational boundary, it is traversing from one organization to another organization, and the ownership is changing, the onus of managing the data, that is changing. So that's a very important aspect of industrial IoT. Secure, yes, that's, we have to plan securing, and that's where the various concepts of isolation comes into. So when I'm planning an architecture, the architecture is not just one system of one deployment, but in the case of smart city as an example, it is about a system of systems, you know. So that's where we have to have proper isolation techniques in place, so that the security remains limited to the area. What I actually meant is that in case of an event, in case of a hack, the event remains contained. We have to keep the event.
It's like the submarines, right? They have different compartments. So you have one system got breached, you just kind of cut it out from the others and you still keep running.
Exactly. That's very important.
So is that in place? Is that a futuristic idea? Is that like prevalent in industrial IoT, or do you see how the adoption for that?
Actually, there are technologies in place, although there are the evolution is happening, and this concept is very much used. The concept of isolation is already used in the IT world. Let's say in the cloud also, like I mentioned earlier, that it's a single point of failure. But if something happens in a cloud facility, there also we have to contain.
Yes.
Any enterprise has to have this the isolation and techniques to contain the failure and not let it spread. Early detection is a key.
I think the cloud companies, or you know, I've seen that in financial companies, they have that at a cloud level or at a software level.
Right.
Doing that with device management is such a huge undertaking.
Exactly. Yeah, so that's again brings back the end-to-end nature of industrial IoT. So it has to happen, like the hardware manufacturers has to think about the hardware isolation. There's process isolation. So yeah, those are also covered here.
This is fantastic. We could go on for hours. I think we are coming to the end of our show. I mean, you make the whole industrial IoT itself is a hard topic to cover, right? Yeah. And on top of that, you make industrial IoT security sound so sexy. And it's just unbelievable. So do you have any last minute advice for somebody who's a business person or a solution architect thinking about this?
Yeah, I think we are at an early stage of a very exciting journey. So the road ahead is the convergence has to happen, a lot of collaboration, and most importantly, understanding, education. I need to understand the whole purview, having a solid understanding of security paradigms is very important. And that's where I think this book is a humble effort, which I think it will help all the practitioners, starting from business leaders and so down the chain. There's a lot of work we have to do in terms of collaboration, you know, simplifying security. Security in itself is a very complex topic. We have to simplify. There's so many security standards, as I was doing my research, even for coding practices. You know, we are telling enterprises to secure their software, but just think of a developer, they have to refer to maybe 5 different standards saying more or less the same things. So there is a lot of confusion. We have to make it simple, reduce the clutter. So that's more a governance responsibility. And also, it's just a journey we have to future-proof. You know, an interesting observation is quantum computing. Today, we are all based on cryptography. Security means cryptography, PKI. Once we embrace the quantum computing world, these are all becoming outdated, challenged. So it's an exciting journey. So we just have to stay tuned and not disconnect ourselves from security. Just embrace it and accept it and right-size it for our deployments.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much, Sravani. Show me your book again. I just love the color of the book. Practical Industrial Internet of Things Security. And it's available on Amazon. I have my ebook copy. So I definitely would recommend it. And thank you, everybody. And you know where to subscribe. And I will see you next time. Bye.